Gentlemen, on behalf of Fritt Ord, I wish you welcome to this awards ceremony and a most special and warm welcome to the prize winners. Welcome also to State Secretary Morten Høglund from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. For us in Free Word, and for me being myself a journalist, this is a day of great importance. The brave work we are about to honor goes to the core of our priorities and brings us directly to the most important challenges of our times. To be a journalist, in my view, is to take responsibility for true and critical history telling. We need a warm heart and a cold brain, a former colleague of mine once said. But both capacities come at a cost. In many countries, at an increasing cost. It is a fact that journalists all over the world are under threat or they are being hampered in their work. Only this year so far, we have seen 42 killings of journalists at work. Also, in our own neighborhood, we have seen some serious setbacks As for the situation of journalists at work this last year, in particular, it seems to be an increasing tendency that journalists are denied possibilities to live and work in their home countries. Several journalists around the globe are forced to flee in order to continue their work. As I prepared for welcoming you last night, I also reported, being myself an active reporter, I reported about the increasing tensions between NATO and Russia. Here today, we are especially concerned about the worsening situation for those trying to report from inside Russia and in Ukraine. It is deeply worrying that our powerful neighbor in the East seems to be moving backwards when it comes to the basic fundamentals for democracy, namely a free press and freedom of expression. The seriousness of the matter is illustrated by journalists having to flee in order to continue the work as mentioned. We have two outstanding examples among our prize winners here today, who both have had to escape their home places. Galina Timchenko, now working for a free Russian press from her new base in Latvia, and Valentina Samar, who had to get away from her Crimea after threats. This year, we don't have a prize winner from Azerbaijan. This does not mean that we do not follow the situation there closely. One of our earlier prize winners, Kadia Ismailova, is still being kept in prison. But there is an ongoing campaign worldwide both to continue her work and to get her released. Fritt Ord is also continuing to support other journalists working out of Azerbaijan. And our governing board, together with our administration, will actually this coming autumn visit the country for a closer follow-up on the issues of freedom of speech. It seems to me that it might also be brave to come here and receive your prizes. For us, living under very different conditions, it is much needed and necessary to learn from your stories. Thank you. Thank you all for coming, and thank all of you in particular who are willing to risk so much for taking responsibility for truth-telling and building the cornerstones of civil rights and democracy. On behalf of Fritt Ord, I would also like to thank the Zeit Stiftung for an ongoing and very good cooperation for more than 10 years. I think we share the opinion that this is one of our most important tasks, and especially in the present climate between East and West. Thank you all, and welcome once again. And now please welcome our State Secretary, Morten Høglund. The floor is yours.
Honored laureates, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very honored to have been invited to this prestigious event here at the Nobel Institute. This is a day of celebration. But given the troubling developments we are seeing in the world today, it's also a day of concern. Every year, Fritt Ord and Zeit Stiftung award prizes to outstanding journalists and representatives of the media in Russia and Eastern Europe. This year, the prizes are being awarded to six courageous journalists and media outlets from Russia, Ukraine, and Georgia. In my view, the jury has once again made an excellent decision. The laureates, the weekly newspaper Pskovskaya Gubernia and editor Galina Timchenko from Russia, the news agency Slitsvo Info, and the journalists Sergei Harmash and Valentina Samar from Ukraine, along with the online medium Netkazety from Georgia, know what freedom of expression really means. You have promoted free speech and independent media in your own countries in different ways and often under severe pressure. I'm delighted to see you here in Oslo to receive your awards. Promoting freedom of expression and strengthening the independent media are key priorities for the Norwegian government. Why? Because freedom of expression is the foundation on which all other democratic freedom rests. It is essential for the realization of other fundamental rights, like freedom of assembly, freedom of religion, and the right to information. It is a cornerstone of democracy. Today, however, freedom of expression is under pressure in a number of countries, not the least in Russia and Eastern Europe. It is one of the most severely threatened human rights. The appalling attacks in Paris and Copenhagen earlier this year are a clear reminder that freedom of expression must never be taken for granted, neither in Europe nor elsewhere in the world. Freedom House recently published its annual report on freedom of the press. The report found that global press freedom declined in 2014 to its lowest point in a decade, with only 1 in 7 people living in a country with a fully free media. Impunity, restrictions on access to information, defamation suits, restrictive media laws, and censorship continue to undermine freedom of expression and freedom of the media. The ability of journalists to gain access to and report freely from certain countries and from protest sites and conflict areas has also declined dramatically. As the ancient Greek dramatist Aeschylus wrote, "In war, truth is the first casualty." And he has been quoted ever since. His words still ring true today, not least when we think of the conflict in eastern Ukraine. Propaganda can be spread easily through the social media, as it can through state-controlled media. Today we are faced with competing versions of events and different so-called truths. Journalists working in the field and trying to decipher the facts have a hugely important job, perhaps more so than ever before. The Norwegian government recently presented the first Norwegian white paper on human rights in 15 years. It puts human rights at the center of our foreign and development policy and identifies freedom of expression as one of Norway's main priorities. The Norwegian Ministry of Foreign Affairs is currently drawing up a strategy to strengthen our efforts in this field. We are already doing a lot. We promote freedom of expression in the UN, the Council of Europe, and the OSCE. We support the work of freedom of expression organizations and media organizations, and we support efforts to provide safety training to journalists. We were especially pleased to provide support for the safety handbook for journalists working in Russia and Ukraine, which was published last week by the International Federation of Journalists and the Norwegian Union of Journalists. The handbook is the result of a joint initiative by Russian and Ukrainian journalists. It is hoped that the handbook will also be useful for many other journalists working in conflict areas or hostile environments. We now intend to intensify our work to promote freedom of expression and the independent media through even more targeted action at all levels. We all know only too well that journalists in many countries are harassed, threatened, and even killed for simply doing their jobs and reporting events as they see them. Some of the laureates recognized here today have taken serious personal risks in connection with their work. Some have even had to leave their home countries. Honored laureates, you are brave. You are an inspiration to all of us that believe in the value of freedom of expression and independent media. I urge you to continue your important work. Do not lose courage when you are confronted with new obstacles. Please keep exercising your right to freedom of expression. I wish you every success in your future reporting. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Manfred Lahnstein. I'm the chairman of the board of trustees of the Zeit Foundation in Hamburg. Dear Mr. Höland, dear Mrs. Slapgard, dear prize recipients, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, we should not have gathered today on this festive occasion. The Prize Free Press Eastern Europe and the Prize Free Press Russia should no longer have been handed out because it should no longer be necessary. And yet, here we are again. Today is the 16th time the Hamburg-based Zeit Foundation, Gerd and Evelyn Bucerius, presents its prize-free press Eastern Europe. And it is the 12th time that we can do it together with our highly esteemed partners of Stiftelsen Fried Uhr here in Oslo. During these years, we have been able to honor close to 100 recipients with a total amount of close to 2 million euro. I hope that we all agree this festive gathering is not an occasion to be self-congratulatory, proud, or joyful. As I said, under normal circumstances, this prize would have become superfluous already a while ago. And this precisely was our hope when we started way back in 2000. It had been our hope that all European countries would enjoy freedom of opinion, freedom of information, and independent media. Well, this hope has been brutally shattered. Freedom of opinion, ladies and gentlemen, cannot really exist and survive with freedom of information. Freedom of information needs free media, needs independent journalists. May they provide us with facts or opinions, articles or pictures. And to me, this basic freedom should know only one limit: the dignity of all human beings. The primary goal of independent journalism is not to criticize politicians or governments, bankers or high-ranking civil servants. The primary goal, as you have pointed out, is to find out and to tell the truth as best as is possible. Well, if and whenever this truth runs against the vested interests of those in power, be it. Those vested interests invoke an equally powerful phantom, their version of the interest of the state. Without any doubt, there is such a thing as the interest of the state. The question is, however, how this interest is defined and by whom. The work of the journalist is helping to restrict it and to have it defined in a legal, open, and democratic process. Furthermore, the work of the journalist is to lay bare inconsistencies, lies, and unacceptable behavior of the respective nomenclatura. A widespread corruption is only one example which comes to my mind. It is precisely this process those in power in countries like Russia, Belarus, Azerbaijan, or Armenia are afraid of. They don't give in, let alone give up. They react. This reaction may be more or less brutal. It remains unforgivable. Let me only remind you that Rauf Mirkadirov, one of our prize recipients in 2008, and Kadia Ismailova, our recipient in 2012, are in jail since last year. Both have been working in Baku, Azerbaijan, the city of the so-called European Games. Well, this striking contrast between panem et circenses and oppression is not new. We will not be impressed by pomp and circumstance. Rauf and Kadia, we will not forget you. As far as the recipients of this year's prize are concerned, my wholehearted congratulations, some words have been already said, others will be said now by Theo Sommer, the chairman of the prize jury and a long, long-term member of our board of trustees. I want to assure you, ladies and gentlemen, that we will continue to pay our modest contribution to a much bigger and everlasting fight, and it is an honor for the Zeit Foundation that we can do so together with our friends and colleagues from Stiftelsen Fried Ward. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you so much. We are very honored to present some music for you on this occasion. At the bass is Mats Eilertsen. We have Kim Lovely on accordion.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. State Secretary, friends, and above all, award winners. I'm Theo Sommer, and as chairman of the jury that has the honor of selecting the winners of the Geert Bucerius Prize Free Press Eastern Europe and the Fritz Ohr Prize Free Press Russia, it is my great pleasure to welcome you to this award ceremony. And let me start saying something that Manfred Landstein also alluded to. I would rather not be here today. I wished, and I'm sure all of you share this feeling, that there would be no need to hand out awards to journalists who do nothing but their professional duty, gathering and disseminating information, comment, and background. But alas, in this world of ours, even along Europe's periphery and its near abroad, the freedom of expression, Fritz Ohr, is being trampled upon and trodden underfoot. The powers that be threaten, harass, and muzzle journalists who uphold the freedom of the media, which is the very bedrock of democracy. A shocking number of our colleagues have been brutally murdered. Numerous others go about their business under the constant threat of persecution. And in most of the 100 countries Reporters Without Borders has recently evaluated, the situation for journalists and independent media has considerably worsened during the past year. And this is particularly noticeable in Russia, where the truth is increasingly considered an anti-state position, and the media spreading it are bullied around or suppressed. To be true, freedom of expression, freedom of speech, is guaranteed in the Constitution. Not so, however, freedom after the speech. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the reason why we today are here once again assembled in the hallowed halls of the Nobel Institute, to honor and encourage journalists, newspapers, internet platforms that keep waving the banner of media freedom
in the face of authorities frequently inclined to make short shrift of critics, dissidents, and opponents. The Bucerius Prize Free Press Eastern Europe is named after the founder and owner of Die Zeit, Germany's leading quality weekly. Gerd Bucerius was a shrewd lawyer, an accomplished politician, a successful publisher, and a high-powered journalist himself. He entered the public arena after World War II to make sure that never again the freedom of the media would be suppressed in our country. It was in his spirit that in 2000, 5 years after his death, the Zeit Foundation set up the Gerd Bucerius Prize Free Press Eastern Europe. In Eastern Europe, we felt, after the collapse of communism, democracy could not flourish without a vivacious free press, without watchful media, and without fearless journalists. And since 2004, Die Zeit Foundation has been cooperating with the Norwegian Institutionen Frit Ur. Frit Ur has long been focusing on the fate of media freedom in post-communist Russia, and I'm very happy to repeat that from the very beginning our cooperation has been smooth, constructive, and fruitful. We in Hamburg are proud of the partnership with our friends in Oslo. Today, it is the 16th time that we hand out our award, and the 12th time that we do this together with Frit Ur. Manfred Lahnstein mentioned the figures, but I think they are impressive enough to bear repetition. Including this year's awards, the Bucerius Prize and Frit Ur's Prize have so far been bestowed on 97 award winners, 40 individual journalists, and 57 media institutions. Most of them were daily and weekly newspapers, but in recent years, news agencies and internet platforms have increasingly been included. All told, the prize money defrayed in our 16 years amounts to almost 1.8 million euros. I think it was money well invested. It strengthened the free word in the post-communist orbit, and it encouraged fearless publications and journalists. This year, six prizes totaled 75,000 euros. And they go to three journalists, two internet platforms, and one newspaper. Two from Russia, three from Ukraine, and one from Georgia. Now, before congratulating our six award winners, I would like to say a heartfelt thank you to all those whose dedication, experience, and judgment constitute the pillars upon which our undertaking rests. We owe a world of thanks to our country specialists. They sift and evaluate stacks of newspapers and reams of internet publications in a dozen different languages. And their assessment provides the basis for our selection process. And then we owe, of course, thanks to all those who submit to us proposals for plausible award candidates. This year, we received 42 nominations from embassies, from foundations, from OSCE representatives, and not least from former awardees. And I am also greatly indebted to the members of our jury, their competence, and their wisdom. And we are all grateful for the unwavering support of our two motherships, the Zeit Foundation and Frit Ur. Slutligen, så skulle jag vilja säga tack så mycket till Nobelinstitutet för att återigen välkomna oss i denna historiska byggnaden. Desslikes tackar jag statssekreterare Mårten Höglund det är en stor heder för oss att ni har övertagit I dags lovtal på våra pristagare. Thank you very much, sir. By way of conclusion, let me simply congratulate this year's award winners. I wish them all the best in their private lives. I wish them steadfastness in their professional pursuits. And I wish them, last not least, the ultimate success in their public endeavors, which they and their countries deserve. Thank you very much. We shall now proceed to handing out the awards. And Sigrun, would you join me up here? Thank you. Thank you very much. The first winner is Skotskaya Gubernia, represented by Mr. Schlossberg. Pleasure of awarding you the 2015 Fritz Ur Foundation and the Zeit Foundation Press Prizes for Russia and Eastern Europe. The weekly newspaper Pskovskaya Guvernia in Northwest Russia will receive a prize of euro 15,000. The newspaper has fearlessly covered the conflict in Ukraine, not least by publishing texts about dead Russian soldiers in East Ukraine. The journalists also explore a wide range of issues of relevance to democracy in the region of Pskov and the rest of Russia. The weekly newspaper was nominated by the Human Rights House Foundation Oslo and the Norwegian Helsinki Committee. Yours sincerely, Dr. Knut Olaf Omos, and Professor Manfred Landstein. Congratulations.
The next prize winner is Galina Timchenko. Of awarding you the 2015 Fritz-Ur Foundation and Zeit Foundation Press Prizes for Russia and Eastern Europe. Galina Timchenko will receive a prize of euro 10,000. The former editor-in-chief is one of the most popular online Russian newspapers. Lenta RU is currently working from Latvia to promote a free Russian press. Due to Russian censorship following the annexation of Crimea, she was forced to set up Operation Riga, where she has founded a news portal, Medusa. Along with the former staff of Lenta.ru, she continues to engage in independent journalism and to present information to a Russian and an international audience. The Goethe Institute in Moscow nominated Galina. Congratulations.
The next one is the representative of Slitsvo.info. Would you come up? We have the pleasure of awarding you the 2015 Fritz Ur Foundation and the Zeit Foundation Press Prizes for Russia and Eastern Europe. Slidstvo.info, an agency for investigative journalism based in Kiev, will receive 15,000 euros. Their professional brand of investigative journalism has been conveyed through reports and TV programs bearing the agency's name. Among other things, they have reported on the oligarchs' control of Ukrainian gas resources and on widespread corruption, in addition to turning a critical spotlight on the currently unfolding military disaster. Slidstvo.info was nominated by the Human Rights House Foundation, Oslo, and the Norwegian Helsinki Committee. And the document is signed by the two gentlemen who also signed the checks.
Journalist and editor-in-chief in the online newspaper Ostrovy. He will receive a prize of 10,000 euro. Ostrovy is one of the most popular news platforms in East Ukraine. Seri Armash is well known for his astute political and economic analysis. He has made an impressive contribution to freedom of the press and information with his objective critical reports from the crisis in Ukraine. Most of the journalists at Ostrovy left Donetsk in 2014, including Harmash. He was nominated by the Friedrich Neumann Foundation for Freedom Potsdam. Congratulations.
Valentina Samar. We have the pleasure of awarding you the 2015 Fritz-Bohr Foundation and the Zeit Foundation Press Prizes for Russia and Eastern Europe. Valentina Samar, born in 1965 from Crimea, will receive a prize of 10,000 euros. She was forced to leave Crimea last year, fearing for her life. She does not hesitate to publish critical articles on political topics or to investigate corruption carried out by the state authorities in Ukraine. The Ukrainian journalist has published a number of thought-provoking articles about the Ukrainian-Russian war. Valentina Samar was nominated for the press prize by the Friedrich Naumann Foundation for Freedom, Potsdam. Congratulations.
Georgia will receive 15,000 euro. The politically independent news and multimedia portal reported inter alia on the details of violations of the rights of Georgian Muslims violence against women and homophobia. Negaceti offers broad coverage of social problems in the national news. As regards international news, Negaceti has given its reader a good platform for understanding the conflict between Russia and Ukraine. Negaceti was nominated by the German Embassy in Tbilisi and by the Heinrich Böll Foundation Office in South Korea.
Dear colleagues, my name is Dmytro Gnap. I'm a journalist investigator from Kyiv, Ukraine, and my colleague Valentina Samar shared me this right to talk this speech to you from whole Ukrainian delegation. First of all, I want to thank Free Thought Foundation and Sight Foundation for the award, but more than this, for the ability to establish connections with bright reporters, our colleagues from other countries. It's an honor of us for Slidstvo Investigative Project. Slidstvo Info, this is an investigative unit of Hromadsky TV. Hromadsky TV, this is a Ukrainian online TV independent broadcaster, and I'm one of co-founders of Hromadsky TV. Also, this is honor for my colleagues Valentina Samar and Serhii Harmash, well-known and brave Ukrainian reporters. They worked hard for sharing information from Crimea and Donbas, occupied today Ukrainian regions. So we are proud that this modest work of Ukrainian reporters estimated so high by international jury. And this is a happy moment for all of us, but it's not the time for drinking champagne. Because today in modern journalism faced dangerous challenges. Many basic values of modern journalism used by dictators and terrorist groups, freedom of speech and balance of opinion used for sharing the message needed for awful bastards. Victims are no longer the object of journalist condolences. Victims became the effective weapon in new type of war, informational war. Social networks are no longer the fastest way of getting important information from the event location, because social works transform it into a virtual world filled by fakes, fake accounts, fake news, fake opinions. Propaganda today created not so stupid or straight messages as it was in the past. Propaganda today create modern media, and they get their market share. We are wrongly supposed that Mr. Putin is a medieval dictator, but he understands principle of informational war better than many Western analysts. We suppose that ISIS leaders are like some kind of savages, but they use social networks better than many Western government structures. And we see that there is no, all these challenges here in Ukraine. Ukrainian journalism faced these challenges last year, when Russia annexed Crimea and started hybrid war in Donbas. This time became the running point to revise many typical journalist standards, beginning from lexicon and to personal estimation of reporter. How can we call army troops guerrillas if they are armored by tanks and Zenit missiles? How can we be unbiased when one of the sides doesn't distort facts, but construct absolutely fake reality? These problems journalists faced not only in Ukraine, but also in Middle East, and it would be good if it doesn't happen against in Europe. And we see that there is no magic medicine to treat this toxic pollution of media sphere. We have just a set of old school tools like reputation, networking, and hard work. It's not so impressive like a propaganda, but we remain honest with our audience and remain honest to ourselves. Being honest, this is the main thing. Whatever new format and whatever new standards, being honest is one unchangeable principle in this profession. This is the one way to develop our media or to find our new colleagues and new friends in other countries and sometimes collect serious awards like this. Thank you very much.
Меня зовут Лев Шлосберг. Я представляю газету «Псковская губерния», город Псков, Россия. Мое выступление называется «Главное условие свободы». Глубоко уважаемые коллеги, дамы и господа, от имени редакции газеты «Псковская губерния», с любезного согласия коллег, я благодарю фонд «Свобода слова» и фонд Герда Буцериуса за высокую честь премии «Свобода слова». Ваше признание труда журналистов важно и для нас, и для нашей аудитории. Миллионов граждан России, для которых главной ценностью в жизни является свобода. Еще в конце 20 века мы не предполагали, что обсуждение возможности или невозможности свободы станет главным вопросом повестки дня в России в начале 21 века. Угрозы свободе казались преодоленными, политические и экономические кризисы казались частью только политической и экономической борьбы. Все участники этой борьбы пользовались свободой, в первую очередь свободой слова. Казалось, что свобода слова необходима всем, и никто не поставит перед собой задачу ликвидации свободы слова. Тем не менее, сегодня, на 15-м году нового столетия, свободы слова и свободы как таковой в России меньше, чем было в течение последних 25 лет. 30 лет назад первые шаги к свободе в несвободной стране были сделаны именно с помощью свободы слова. Вначале было слово. И никаких других начал быть не могло. Свобода слова является первым и главным условием свободы. Любая угроза свободе начинается с угрозы свободе слова. Невозможно уничтожить свободу, не уничтожая свободу слова. Миссия свободных средств массовой информации везде и всегда заключается в том, чтобы свободное слово находило дорогу к обществу. Политическая система России в 21 веке движется от свободы к несвободе. И первой жертвой на этом пути стала свобода слова. Сегодня в нашей стране нет политически значимых, общероссийских общенациональных, свободных средств массовой информации. И это является условием разрушения свободы всего народа, условием строительства государства несвободы. Этот путь страна прошла всего за 10 с небольшим лет, и этот путь, к большому сожалению, еще не завершен. Ценности свободы, в том числе ценности свободы слова, не могут быть принесены извне. Они должны быть выстраданы, приняты и поняты как отдельным человеком, так и всем народом. Для этого нужно не только время. Для этого нужна политическая воля. Свобода народа воспитывается, и это воспитание требует терпения. Реформы 1980-х годов в СССР и после них реформы 1990-х годов в России не принесли свободы и не стали успешными потому, что на каждом шагу обладающие политической властью лица, принимая судьбоносные для страны решения, многократно жертвовали свободой человека как высшей ценностью, не принимали голос общества как проявление свободы, без понимания которого невозможно построить страну и государство. Ценности свободы не стали потребностью большинства народа, не оказались в массовом сознании условием личных жизненных достижений и основой общенационального успеха, не принесли обществу понимания того, что свобода, в том числе свобода слова, это кислород жизни каждого человека. Потребность в свободе, как и потребность в свободном слове, в правде, относятся к изначальным, естественным потребностям человека. Но эти потребности проявляются именно в условиях свободы. В условиях несвободы эти потребности подавляются и даже извращаются. На место свободы приходят авторитаризм, тоталитаризм и диктатура. На место свободы слова и правды приходит ложь. Все несвободные политические режимы держатся на лжи и насилии. Ложь и насилие неразрывно связаны между собой, являются условиями друг друга, условиями несвободы. Для политического режима, в основе которого лежат ложь и насилие, свобода слова представляет собой главную угрозу. Такой политический режим стал реальностью в России сегодня. Владимир Путин начал свою деятельность в должности президента России с последовательной борьбы со свободой слова, всеми институтами политической свободы. Он достиг многого на этом пути и сделал Россию несвободной страной. Но он не смог добиться ликвидации той части российского общества, для которой свобода, в том числе свобода слова, является естественным условием жизни. Эта часть общества в России сегодня продолжает искать, говорить и обнародовать правду. Эта часть общества представлена сегодня в России немногочисленными средствами массовой информации, которые понимают, помнят и выполняют свою миссию. Миссию свободного слова. В этих средствах массовой информации работают граждане России, для которых главной ценностью в жизни является свобода. У этих средств массовой информации в России есть сегодня аудитория. Это люди, которым необходимо свободное слово, необходима правда. Ценности свободы объединяют миллионы людей в России и несколько десятков независимых средств массовой информации, сохранивших в неприкосновенности идеалы и принципы свободного слова. От того, смогут ли журналисты свободных средств массовой информации в России выстоять, остаться верными своей миссии, зависит возвращение свободы миллионам людей. Потому что и тысячи лет назад, и десятки лет назад, и тысячи лет после, в начале было и будет слово. Свободное слово способно вернуть обществу утраченную свободу, потому что рано или поздно человек слышит свободное слово, понимает и осознает его смысл. Судя по происходящим сегодня событиям, свободному слову предстоит долгая дорога в России. Во всяком случае, наши 40 лет еще не прошли. На этом пути граждане России исповедующие свободу слова, должны быть спокойны, уверены в себе и терпеливы. Свободное слово остается первым и главным условием свободы. Спасибо всем тем, кто говорит, ищет и поддерживает свободу слова.
Thank you. alone.